Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. You're needing more, and you don't need it from any source. You need it from the Lord. You're needing more. And search for her as a hid treasure. That means you're not giving up. When you're searching for wisdom, you don't throw in the towel. If you were hunting for a treasure, people hurt themselves almost. They kill themselves looking for treasure. If we were to do this for wisdom and understanding, my goodness, that means when a situation came, we would not run from the situation, that will yield the wisdom. Here's what I'm telling you. Your situation is for your education. It is so that you can have wisdom and understanding. That's what your situation is for, among other things. But if you reject it, if you think, oh, the devil's doing this, oh, this is too overwhelming. First of all, you're not going to be in a situation that's overwhelming, so never say that. The Lord never places anything upon you beyond that which you can bear. So anything that transpires in your life, you're able to take. So we can't say, oh, I can't do this, because yes, you can. You can't say that anymore. Not by way of truth. That means you don't want the situation. And the truth is, here it is. Don't get mad at me, though. Here's the truth. We want the gifts without the exercise. Every gift you get is granted to you, but things must be exercised in you so those gifts will be fully qualified and useful. We want the gifts. We don't want what it takes to actually embrace them or get them. We just want to have them for free. We don't want the maturity that's necessary for the gift. If the Lord gave you the gift to discern somebody else's heart, would he just do that without you being mature? No, he would not. If you can discern somebody's heart, there's some more things you have to be able to do. Number one, you have to be in complete control over your emotional state. What if you came across a murderer that did not murder yet, but you knew a person wanted to murder? How would you talk to that person? What if you came up to a person who wanted to rape, and you could see it as clear as day that this person had a hunger for rape, but he never raped anybody? How could you talk to this person? You have to be able to communicate with a person knowing these things. If the Lord's going to open that gift up to you, you have to have a tight maturity. Because if you're going to lose your control, he's not going to give you the gift. That gift will never open up. You've got to be able to see the devil in a person and still present to them God Almighty, just as you would a child. You can know a lot about people and their intentions. Some people see patterns. I'm one of those type people. I see patterns a lot, but I don't judge. I can never judge. I know that the day I judge somebody is the day I'll be blind forever. I know that that will be the consequence of my judging somebody else. If I ever judge, if it ever comes in, I don't have to even go through with the activity. If it ever comes up in my heart, I will not have any of the gifts the Lord has given me. I already know this, but I can talk to people who have a desire to do terrible things. I can even talk about those desires, and they will not deny them. They just simply say, well, how do you know? Nobody knows. How do you know? But I talk to them about them when I'm talking about Scripture to let them know, yes, we have evil things inside of us. The flesh is evil. It desires evil, but the Lord is good, and Jesus has come to free us from that bondage. That's a good message, huh? That's what appeals to people out there. When you can tell them what they're about, but then tell them about Jesus and do so with a loving heart, then you're working. Otherwise, the Lord's not going to allow his gifts to be used for any earthly purpose so somebody can judge somebody else. See, Satan does the opposite. He gives tool sets to people. They go hunting on the internet and everything else to find something to accuse you of. God doesn't do that. The Lord will not have you talk to a stranger. He will let you know everything about anybody you approach. If you are mature in the Spirit, he will open up things you never thought possible. If you're mature in the Spirit, if your heart is in the right place. So you have to open up your heart to understanding and not be so rejective of everything that happens. You cannot be a person that blames. You must be a person that assumes responsibility. You can't be a finger pointer, because I understand that people are driven by things they cannot comprehend. They still think that their thoughts are theirs. They don't know what they really are. They still think that emotions are necessary. They don't know what they really are. They're still calling them emotions. I've heard people talk about emotions. Well, emotions, this emotion and that emotion. Here's the problem. Even the word emotion did not come from the living God, but it came from mankind. And the description of emotions did not come from the living God, but they came from mankind. So that knowledge, that psychology came from mankind, but people utilize that trying to discern the Bible. It's not going to work. You can't use the language of Babylon and enter into something holy and expect to have some knowledgeable understanding outcome of it. You can't do that. So when I hear people do this, I know they don't know. There's no need for me to point that out. You don't point out an error somebody's making unless you're ready to instruct them on how to overcome that error. It does no good to point out an error you cannot instruct a person to overcome. Do you all see how that works? Anyway, then it says, if you do these things, then shall you understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. So if you're not doing these things, then the opposite is true. You will not understand the fear of the Lord, and you will not find the knowledge of God. See, in the Bible, it says there are some people, they are forever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. How can somebody learn, but never come to the knowledge of the truth? We're talking about it right here. This is a principle spoken by the wisest person that ever was or ever would be. So if your heart is not willing to accept what you see before you, if you're rejective of so many things, you're compromised emotionally, in your own feelings, whatever the case is, you're going to reject things by way of your heart. If you're critical without a solution, you're just going to be a fault finder. Find fault in somebody's speech. That's all you're going to hear, the faults. Not listening to the meat of the conversation, but only hearing the faults. That's when Satan has your ears, by the way. And you're not going to embrace any understanding by way of heart. And notice one of the key terms here. Apply thine heart to understanding, not your head. Your heart. This is a big issue. People have been educated in the world, and they bring the worldly learning and education into the church. That doesn't work, because you're going to leave your flesh mind. That's going to be gone. That does not translate with the spirit. All things of your flesh will not translate with the spirit. It's going to be left with a dead body, your brain with it. That means the way you solve problems, all the memories you have and everything else that are in the mind are going to be gone. You're going to be left a spirit with out that carnal and flesh mind you had. Your spirit is eternal, and the spiritual things that we move upon here, that we teach about here, this is so that we grow spiritually, not by way of the body. Intellect is good for men. It is not good for the spirit, because it will not translate into eternity. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Your brain is flesh and blood. Your memories are encapsulated in your mind. That's what your memories are. But your spirit is different. This is why Jesus gives us a born-again spirit with a whole different mind structure. It is not that of the flesh. That shouldn't be difficult to comprehend. It's just impossible, because we're still in the flesh, and we're talking about things of the spirit which man cannot see. And that takes faith to believe. So you're not going to have proof of the spirit. You can have proof of the brain and the concepts of the brain, but that's not what we're talking about. Let's continue. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. Now, this is so interesting. Proverbs 2:6. Now, keep this in mind. Look at his knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. Thank you, Lord. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the ways of his saints. He preserves the ways of his saints. Do the saints preserve their own ways? Nope. He does. He's always intervening. Why? If we're to be like Christ, then we are to be joined with who? Jesus said, it is not me that doeth the works, but my Father. Whatever the Father speaks, I speak, Jesus said. Jesus kept telling people it's not him. If we're to be one and the same as Christ, if he is the first of many brethren and our Savior and Messiah, our King, then we know that born-again spirit is the key. It is the beginning of a very new life, not like the old. That's why in the Bible it says the carnal mind is against God. Anybody know what carnal means? Carnal does not mean evil. That's not what it means. Carnal things are natural earthbound things, flesh things. That means you have a flesh mind. It is against God. It conspires against God. It is the thing that doubts what it cannot see, what it cannot hear, what it cannot touch or prove. It is the element of all of us that will fight against the spirit. Like the apostle said, the spirit and the flesh do war against one another. They fight against one another. The spirit needs no proof. The flesh does. The flesh must deduce what is real. The spirit operates by what is real. The flesh, you must have evidence for what is true. The spirit speaks truth. Listen, it says, he that layeth up sound wisdom for righteousness, he is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment. He preserveth the ways of the saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. When wisdom entereth in thine heart and knowledge in is pleasant unto thy soul. Not rejected, but pleasant. That's a big deal. That's a big difference. Listen, here it is again. When wisdom entereth into thine heart. And what else though? And knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul. Now the soul is something that cannot be tracked. It cannot be quantified, or that is to say, it can't be measured or anything. The soul cannot. So the soul is one of those invisible parts of us that makes up the whole of us. The part we can't see that we don't really know about. When knowledge is pleasant unto your soul, when it's well with you, when it is embraceable to you. And that comes when your heart is in the right place, because your heart has to be willing to not resist understanding first. If you resist understanding by way of the heart, that means you have understanding of something else. If you doubt a scripture, it's because you believe in something else. Now we have a witchcraft society right now, and everything is based in marketing, and the other half is based in evidence and proof. Now everybody thinks they're some sort of private investigator. They want to go find out everything, and the internet gives them the power to get their little papers together. And when they get enough papers together, they say, ha, I have found it. And then they say, hey, guess what? I know what you don't know over there. And then they start competing with the knowledge, and everybody wants to be first. Everybody's in a mad dash to be the first one to discover what? They want to be the first. You'll hear that over and over. I was the first one who knew that. I was the first one who knew this. We were the first ones who put this out. Who cares? When your mind is spiritual, you really don't care about first. You care about your brother and your sister. If the last person came up with something that would help the brothers and sisters, that's what you would remember. And you wouldn't say, I was the first. You would say, the Lord has blessed me, given me favor to do so and so. Because you don't take credit once you start walking spiritually. When wisdom entereth into thine heart, knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul. Discretion shall preserve thee. You know what I found out over the course of my life, and well, it's just not me, it's many others. Discretion is a value from our Father. Discretion is like having something, but not always showing that you have it. That's what discretion is. That means you have something, but you don't always show that you have it. And discretion shall preserve thee. That's a beautiful statement and a true statement. In most situations where people's lives are torn down, a lack of discretion was always exhibited. Those who had great discretion were always, they seemingly are always kept from massive disasters in life. Those who have discretion. And it's so funny because it doesn't matter if you're a saint or not a saint. See, the world, they may not know this, but they operate by a lot of the principles of Christ and they prosper by it. Christians know the person of Christ, but we lack the principles. We know the person of Christ, which grants us a longing to be in the right path with the Lord, a longing to obey Him, a longing to be with Him. The world does not have that longing, but they do operate by principles of Christ, principles of our Father. If the Christians would ever begin to adopt the principles, my goodness, then you have a flourishing, and that will happen. In the days to come. See, a great divide is taking place even right now. You guys know in the Bible when it says many are going to fall away, many must fall away, and then that man of perdition is going to be revealed. Many will fall away first. Then that man of perdition is going to be revealed. But he won't be revealed until the falling away happens. Do you remember how it's set up in the book of Isaiah? You guys know how it's also set up in the book of Ezekiel? What about Zephaniah? Same thing. It's set up this way all throughout the Word of God. And the falling away, by the way, is not people not believing in Jesus. They're following an alternate belief system. They still believe in Jesus, but not the Jesus we're familiar with. It's more of a hybrid gospel. So it's almost like falling away without falling away. That's clear in the Old Testament that they're still going to have their religion, but the religion is different. And the Lord kept saying, unless you become like one of these, you will in no wise enter into the kingdom of God, like one of those children. That's a big statement to me. Now, a child is not dumb. They're unlearned, but they're not dumb. To become like a child is what, though? If you look at the qualities of a child, it used to be when a parent told the children, jump in the car, you guys go with me, the children didn't say, where are we going? There was a discipline involved, and they wouldn't question whether you know how to drive. Can you imagine that? If you say, come on, let's go, let's jump in the car and let's go to the mall. What if your child that was 4 years old looked at you and said, do you really know how to drive? But a child doesn't do that, do they? Their questions are defined by very simple things, a very simple rule set. They don't ask you if you know how to drive or not. If you feed them, they don't ask you, did you know what you were doing when you were cooking this? They normally don't ask that. So that means they do trust in certain things, and they will never question certain things. They just won't do it. But I'm telling you, this world is set up so that if you become smart in this world, you can actually be locked into it and you won't escape. Why do you think I'm so forceful when it comes to the topic of intellect? I know a trick that's being played, and very seldom do people ever escape it. I know what it can do, and most people who are highly educated, they cannot have the faith that the youngest of us can have. They just can't do it. Once you're highly educated in this world, you're almost fully indoctrinated into something you would never be a part of if you knew the truth of it. And if you don't believe me, find any of you who have a doctorate or a master's degree. You know it's very difficult for you to read the scriptures and simply intake the scriptures. You know that's not easy for you to do because you've been trained to do what? It's a subject called critical thinking. One of the first things you do is start breaking everything down to small pieces. You're looking for rhetorical devices, language usage, and everything else. But you're breaking it down according to the world's view, and the world's ways, and the world's language. And that's where people mess up. Because they take worldly education and try to apply it to a word that must be received by faith. What does it say about the word of God? It must be discerned, what? Spiritually. There it is. Not logically. Spiritually. Not by your mental faculties. Spiritually. It must be understood spiritually. And if it's not understood spiritually, you don't understand it. That's the truth. That's what Jesus spoke about. People have done their best to communicate what they have known, but even that still must be understood spiritually. See, that's one thing you cannot get around. It's why me and some theologians don't get along. The basis of theology is Roman. It is an application of the word mixed with government. That is the basis of it. Proverbs 2:12 says, to deliver thee from the way of the evil man, from the man that speaketh froward things, to be delivered from him, who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. And they do. Because people who come back with instant rebuttals, they are bitter. They can't agree with anything. When you're wise, it is said in Proverbs, a wise man is slow to speak and quick to listen. In fact, a wise man will hear everything because he knows what to apply where. He does not need to rebut anything. He won't go against everything. He won't speak his mind either. That's why I don't like that term, speaking your mind. People should go speak that somewhere else and have discretion. Let's continue. None that go down to her return again, neither take they hold of the path of life, that thou mayest walk the way of good men and keep the paths of righteous, of the righteous. For the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it, but the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressors shall be rooted out of it. Now, folks, this last statement is what you're about to see. The wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressors shall be rooted out of it. You're about to see this. You're going to see the wicked all gathered together. That's what the kingdom of the beast is. The kingdom of the beast is a vacuum. And everybody who hears the beast is going to go run to it. They're going to say, I belong there. They're going to go gather with a system, with a way they truly believe in. You Americans, listen to me. It's just like Democrats and Republicans. You identify with either a Democrat or a Republican, right? And then you vote accordingly. The beast system is the same way. You're going to feel a natural drawing toward the beast. People will. They're going to go run to it, but it's a vacuum. It will take all the unrighteous and have them submit to it. They're going to be accounted for. That's when that kingdom is going to be thrust into darkness. Will it have dominion over the earth? For a time it will. Will God's people be protected? Of course they will. But we're also going to be tested during that time. We're going to be tested for what we really believe. For all of you who say you believe in Christ, before you is going to be to choose Christ in a way you don't know what's going to happen to you, insecurities, or the way of the world and the beast. And they're going to grant, they're going to stamp your paperwork and have you live a normal life with greater income than you ever had before. Because the credit system is about to change. Everybody's going to be equaled out. A brand new tracking system, so to speak, is going to be utilized. Integrated with a global system that's already in place, which is why they're giving out money now. It's a warning you're going to begin to hear as people find out more and more about it. There's a whole other society that's rising right beneath ours. The society that we once knew is already dead. It's being dismantled, and a new one is on the rise. You'll see the undoing of it. Most people have it in their heads that the righteous are going to be taken from the earth, leaving all the bad people here. That's not what the word says. You're going to be gathered to be protected. The others will be gathered to be burnt up, to go through God's wrath, gathered into one kingdom. Many of you that are maybe you're 20, 21, or something like that, you're going to behold the fall of the wicked. be strong in those times. Some of the young people, they're growing up differently than we did. You young folks have had to face more obstacles than I have, and I've had to face a lot. Your strength is very different. Your mental resolve, unchallenged. That's why you're so hard-headed now, stubborn, mule-headed, to the point of death you can be. But with righteousness, that means you won't move your foot from the Lord. And because you're already searching for Christ now at a young age, my goodness, you're going to stay your place during the times of great temptation. These young kids endure a lot now. They'll be children of legend shortly enough. Some of us older folks, we're dissociates, and then we'll be gone. Many of the people in my generation, they really are sick right now, but they love the Lord. And they probably will not be here for the whole thing, but they'll certainly see the onset of it. It will come quicker than any of us think, because the Word already tells us that we'll know the season, but the day is going to come upon us so swift, so outside of any recognizable season, that all of us will be a bit shaken by it. But the Lord will be our peace, meaning He, the Lord, will calm us. We're already beholding many things, but the issue is, we have become so accustomed to calamities, we don't see calamities anymore. We're not stirred by volcanism and earthquakes anymore. The only thing we're not accustomed to are troubles in the celestials that we will see. And when you see that, that'll be yet another fulfilled element. But the beast is rising already, and a brand new caliphate has already begun. There's a growing number of people in Israel who really believe the Messiah is in Israel. And guess where they say He is? In secret chambers. No, everybody will see the Lord at the same time. Nobody will ever mistake it is the Lord. You know how it's going to be? You ask yourself, how can everybody recognize Jesus at the same time? Have you guys ever been to a family function of your own, in your own families? You know when you go to a family function and you see somebody walking, you say, is that Greg or is that Dennis or is that so-and-so? How did you know that from a distance? Because you know the walk, you know their shadow, you know everything about them. You have an identification system built into you that is uncanny. And you can see them from so far away, you can recognize who they are by the walk. You say, oh, that's so-and-so. Out of all the people there, you recognize the one. That same recognition is in every living thing concerning Christ Jesus. When He comes back, no one will make a mistake. They will say, there He is. Even the sinners, as it's stated in Revelation, everybody's going to know. But He'll come back once with two impacts. One will be for those who waited on Him. It'll be their day. Their life truly begins. But for the ones who did not wait on Him, but that defiled, that went against Him, it'll be the day they hoped would never come. For them, it'll be the wrath of God. For us, it'll be the fulfillment of His promise. One time, two impacts. He'll come back one time. It'll be seen two ways. I hope all of us will take the path to be good stewards over what He's given us already, because He is coming, and all of what He prophesied, whether we understand it or not, it's going to happen according to His word, His way, not our way, His way. But He did tell us to be ready, didn't He? Today is a good day to begin that life being a good steward. We're about a year into something that nobody has quite recognized yet. It's already taken a toll. Listen, you can cover up the fact that your foundation is crumbling for months until the erosion becomes so enormous that the whole house sinks. This is our situation. There are things right now that they're covering over. You know, you have been to the stores. Something is wrong with every store's inventory. You already know this. They're pumping out money left and right. For what reason? It's like no one is thinking about saving money. But the big thing is that products are missing. There are too many people that you come across who are starving to death. They say they're not employed. Something is wrong. And nobody's telling them. It's like they're covering it up with every story they can possibly conceive of. The moment we're going to know that it's concrete is the moment you go to the store and the doors are locked. Right now, you see products missing. Dust is on certain shelves. Walmart has cut back in what they stock. Even their algorithm is not the same anymore. It is altered and changed. Things are being diverted. Fuel prices and fuel transportation. Something has happened to it in the last week. You'll have a pocket full of money and you won't be able to get fuel. You think they're going to tell you we have a problem. You think a country would tell you that they've sold out to something different. You think they would actually tell their citizens that? No. They want shock and awe because that is the best way to have a transition. That's what all the simulations that the government has run to date has told them, that shock and awe is the best way to transition civilians. In other words, don't tell them anything, but allow them to feel the impact of the other change, and they will accept anything placed before them. And it's already begun. You know what's so funny is about 15 years ago, people would discuss this openly. They even, on shows like this, they would tell the steps that would be taken. Certain people had thought out carefully the steps that would have to be taken before it was shown to everybody else. And I'm telling you, it's playing out just like a playbook, but we have amnesia or something. These are conversations they had prior to 2012. You know, the ones where people were praying to the living God for the truth, and God gave the truth. But obviously, that truth was for a time to come. Now that we're in the time, it's almost like nobody can remember the conversations prior to 2012. Even in the Bible, we read that Jesus said that if time had not been cut short, no flesh would have been saved. No living thing would have been saved. How do I know this? Because the same word flesh that's used in that context was also described as describing the types of flesh that are on the earth. Birds, fish, and plants, and humans, mammals, different types of flesh. Still, the angels are of a different type. These are different encapsulations of the spirit. That same word is being used by Jesus in the New Testament. No flesh would have been saved. So we know we're talking about all life on earth. And the Lord has already told us that it's going to catch people unaware. He gave two distinctions. Number one were the events that will most certainly catch people unaware. But as far as his coming, he said, no one knows hit the day of his coming, not even him. That's reserved to the Father. The Father reserved that unto himself. But he said this. He said, we're going to know the season. He also said, it's going to come before we even expect it to come. He also said, the world is going to be caught off guard. That means scientific evidence is not going to tell you a thing. If the world is going to be caught off guard, you can forget science informing you about the real timing. They're going to be behind the scale because it happened before they were ever ready. And if it happened before they were ever ready, then listen to their projections. And it's going to come well before that because they thought they would have more time and they didn't. And I can tell you right now, they're already prepared. Movements have already been made. A secondary seat of power has already been formed. Your shelves are going empty. Yet the manufacturers are pumping out twice as much as what they used to pump out. Now you figure that out. Why would a manufacturer crank out twice as much as what they used to, yet the store shelves are going empty? What does that tell you? That means all the product is not coming to you. If they're pumping out twice as much, they're filling up something else. Somebody should have put that together. There are two manufacturing facilities that anybody can check out, and they're pumping out twice as much product as they did. Since 2018, they're pumping out twice as much. But in the stores, they're only getting one quarter of what they used to get. Where's the rest of it going? If they're pumping out twice as much, then where's the rest of the product going? Some stuff is right before you all the time. Sometimes you have to get past your own mind and look at the very simple things. Fear will blind you. Fear can cripple you. Fear is against you. You don't have to live with fear. He set your life up to experience deliverance. And if you're going to experience deliverance, you have to be in a situation where you're bound. And all of us have had experience being bound. But we did not. We resisted the Lord in those times of bondage, seeking a quick way out. I'm asking you, face your situation with all faith. I know you're going to be scared, but with all faith and patience, face your situation. Handle it with holiness, not with your own craftiness, but with holiness. Allow the Lord to finish his process in you, and then you'll understand what it is to live a life without fear. And you may call that your first day of life. I know I did. The transition, the contrast was so great. And from that moment, Lord knows I've been fighting that everybody have an experience with the Lord so that they too know that he will deliver them in every situation. You've been delivered thus far. The problem is you don't have that direct identification on the process of you being delivered. We were delivered running away. Don't face it this time. Don't run away. But when the Lord delivers you, you'll give credit to nothing else because he'll make it that way. That means everything around you must fail. In order for you to recognize that God delivered you, every person and everything must fail first. You've been set up for this over and over and over again. Can you recognize it now? Can you see it now? Can you see it now? It wasn't what you thought it was. You have to be in a hopeless situation where everybody else has failed you. Then, when you are delivered, you cannot give credit to this guy, that guy, this institution, that thing over there. You can't. You'll say, the Lord did this. And I tell you, that's what most of us need. I know it changed my life. I just want others. You know, I'm telling you, it's just like that story I told you guys about a guy who found the kingdom. And he went into the kingdom after all of his life struggles. He went into the kingdom and he saw so much room for everybody else. And he immediately thought about those who were like him in the world. And he turned around and he said, can I go invite others? Anybody who will come, they can come. And the man ran out and he never stopped inviting people into the kingdom because he knew they could come too. They were the ones that did not know they could come. When you find the kingdom of God, you'll do the same thing. You're going to run back out to everybody and say, hey, there's room for everybody. But you have to find it first. You have to experience it first. Then you explode with determination, passion, and all love towards your brothers and sisters, forgiving everything they do because you found something much greater than the hottest anger anybody could ever have against you. And you know it's room for everybody. And it is the place everybody's been searching for their entire lives. Some people, they want to be loved. They don't even know that's in the kingdom of God. Some people want all security. They have no idea if that is the kingdom of God. All of what they've been looking for is right there in the kingdom. But if you knew this, you would run out and tell everybody you know, and you would not give up, and you would not so easily turn your back on anybody. You would know they don't know what they're talking about, because if a person knew what the kingdom was, they would not say no. So every time somebody said no, you'd say, well, they don't understand what they're talking about. Lord, give me something to reach them a different way. That's what you would do. It's like some of these devil worshipers. If they knew what hell was, a demon is frightened of hell. If a devil worshiper knew what hell was, they would not be a devil worshiper. That lets me know they need the gospel too. Some people just turn their back on them. I don't. They have no idea what they're asking for. They have been surely beguiled. No, I just need the Lord to strengthen me and to build me up where I can reach them. That's all. If a human knew what hell was, no one would ever go there. If we experienced hell for 2 seconds, not one of us would ever sin again. But the Lord wants us to choose to do good in our freedoms without a threat. That's why we have not been shown certain things yet, because it would not be a genuine decision of the heart. Do you all understand that? If he showed us heaven where we could see it with our eyes, none of us would risk losing it. If he showed us what hell was and we could experience the pain, none of us would risk going to that place, and we would not sin out of great fear of that place. But he does not want us to choose him because we're scared to death of the other place. That's not genuine. With a life that we live where we can choose good and evil and get away with things, any decision we make is coming from our heart. So if we choose him from our hearts, when we see it, we'll never leave him. We'll not fall like the fallen angels did. Can't you see that? There are a lot of people on earth right now, they have no idea what they're talking about. They do evil things because they have no idea what awaits them. Some people doubt the Lord because they have no idea how much truth he really is, how much light he truly is. They have no idea. All these things are kept back that our decision be genuine. That means we have a work to do. But guess what? Before you can do that work, you have to be in a place of security yourself. And the Lord has set up your life to experience some things. Don't fight him on that issue. Your life has been set up so that you can have some confidence and trust in the Lord. We just can't say, I trust you, Lord, and that be a true statement. You have to have experience with the Lord to trust him. And there's so many people who they love him, but they have no experience with him. So when they get in trouble, they're scared to death. See, when you have experience with the Lord, you do not have it. Fear. You don't deal with fear anymore, because when the Lord delivers you, that's the day you perceive of his perfect love, and perfect love casts out all fear. I'm just here to let you know there's a place that fulfills everything, and that place has been prepared, and so has your lives have been prepared. The decision is yours. I can't make that decision for you. You can't take a hostage to the kingdom. But I can tell you this, if you would apply God's principles, you will experience, and once you experience, you'll never turn away again. You'll have your answers. You'll have the peace and the joy of the Lord. We're not talking about temp. Joy is not temporary. Joy is eternal. Happiness is temporary. Joy is eternal. The peace of Christ is always, not sometimes. If you're standing in the middle of a hurricane, you're still going to have the peace of Christ, because in the Word, it's Jesus said, I will give you my joy. You'll have the joy of the Lord, not your joy, not man's joy, but the joy of the Lord, which is continuous. And if you have the joy of the Lord, it is always, not sometimes. See, many of us are missing some of these things. Sometimes we're too prideful to admit it, but I'll tell you right now, there was a time I didn't have them. I searched the Word, I believed in Christ, but I did not have trust in it. I had strong faith, but I did not have trust. I would wait upon the Lord if it killed me, but I didn't have trust. Because the moment I had trust, I didn't fear the situations anymore. There was no anxiety, no anything. There was an absolute knowing I cannot explain to you. To have the joy of the Lord is an intrusive confidence and trust in the Lord, so much so that you don't sit around blaming yourself anymore, nor do you sit in sorrow. You have an eternal joy, but you have a deep yearning for your brothers and your sisters, knowing that the day they understand is the day they actually go home. And the day they go home is the day they'll never turn back. Once you finally get to this place, you'll realize it is home. That's when you turn around and say, hey, there's room for everybody. Let me go out and do anything I can for anyone out there to let them know this place is wide open. This is what we've been looking for. You'll have all the patience in the world with the most evil person in the world. Why? Because if they're evil, you understand they have no idea. The worse a person is, the more you realize they have no idea what heaven or hell is, what the kingdom of God is. You know they don't know those things. Because if they knew those things, they would not be evil. If they knew those things, they would not be resistive. If they knew those things, they would not doubt. So when a person doubts and they're resistive, they just simply don't know. Because if anybody knew, it would change anybody.